The aeroplane was designed for somebody as foolhardy as me, who took things pretty lightly, and it flew itself. And I mean, you could make mistakes in a DAC which another aeroplane would kill you for.
This is the story of the most famous aeroplane of them all, the Douglas Commercial 3, the aircraft they called the Dakota. It was the Dakota which saved Flight Lieutenant Jimmy Edwards' life when he was shot down over Arnhem. It was the Dakota which took troops to D-Day, dropped supplies in Burma, and helped retake the Pacific. Of course, it wasn't designed for war. It was a passenger plane. Last time somebody bothered to check, it had carried 97 million people. But then it's been around for 50 years. Now nostalgia figures in this story, fond memories, affectionate anecdotes amongst those who flew them and flew in them. Those who remember a more exciting age of flying, when just starting the engines was an adventure all its own. At Stansted, London's third airport, Air Atlantique, a tiny British airline, flies DACs because no other aircraft will do. It's the flying equivalent of the tramp steamer, and like the tramp steamer, it hasn't been replaced. You may think of this as a wartime aircraft, disgorging GIs when Miller was playing Moonlight Serenade, but the DAC first flew in 1935 and was setting new standards of comfort long before the war. Mind you, they built 10,000 before the end of 1945, and that alone has made sure the DAC is still going strong. Now it's in the hands of young pilots for whom jets hold no attraction. Theirs is a love affair with a grand old lady, for leaving the ground in a DAC is a unique experience. To Americans who'd spent years flying around in leaking tri-motors held together by fabric and string, the Douglas Commercial, first the one, then the two, and later the most famous version, the DC-3, was style indeed. You could actually hold a conversation with the person next door. There was air conditioning, a pretty stewardess, silver service, a loo, and on the flight deck, an autopilot, the first passenger plane to have one. It didn't leak, it didn't take much maintaining, and above all, it made money for the airlines. It was the first aircraft to make a profit just by carrying passengers. With the Dakota, air transport was changed forever. Started like this when they were flying around in airliners held together with string and sealing wax. A young American called Donald Douglas took on a challenge from Transcontinental and Western Air to design a new plane. TWA's most famous director, Charles Lindbergh, insisted that it must be able to take off and fly on one engine, and that's what the Douglas Commercial 1 could do, just. Test pilot Carl Cover flew it first in July 1933. Later, he flew its big brother, the DC-2, 14 passengers at a stately 150 miles an hour. It was Bill Littlewood of American Airlines who pressed for a bigger DC-2. Douglas came up with the ubiquitous DC-3, and a legend was born. The Dakota was created on the drawing boards in California by a team to which aviation owes much, for their skill and foresight under the direction of Arthur Raymond.
But the DC-3 was a combination of what everybody wanted. We didn't really realize how much it was that at the time. We hadn't any idea how wide the market was going to be. Of course, the big thing was the war that came along, brought those thousands of airplanes we built, but they met It was adaptable, adjustable to practically anybody's need.
50 years on, Arthur Raymond lives high in the hills above Los Angeles, almost within sight of the airport at Santa Monica, from where his revolutionary aeroplane first flew in December 1935.
Did you think then that the aircraft you designed would go on for 50 years?
No. Actually, we had to decide how to design the tooling. And we thought we'd design it for 25 airplanes, but then now we're going to be optimistic. We'll make it 50. So we didn't think too far ahead.
To celebrate this 50th birthday, Dakotas gathered in Holland at an event organized by the Dutch Dakota Association. I have to say that the Dutch are quite mad about the DAC. In 1982, they formed the Dutch Dakota Association, and a year later, bought this 40-year-old DC-3. And since then, they've recruited 2,000 volunteers. KLM 747 captains queue up to fly the DDA Dakota. They're as keen on it as the thousands who turned out to the airfield at Eindhoven to wish the DAC happy birthday. The Americans were there too, appropriately, with a Dakota of the Confederate Air Force, that private flying force where you can be a colonel if you have enough money. After a gargantuan voyage from Texas, this DAC sent the Dutch into raptures.
Everything about the airplane is special to me. My father was a captain with the airlines flying these when I was born, and this is what I learned to fly in. And it's just a fantastic airplane. It'll do things that it was never designed to do, and it'll get you through in times when other planes couldn't make it.
Amongst the judges, Englishman Arthur Piercy, author of countless books on the Dakota, acknowledged as the man who knows most about the aircraft he first flew in 1945 and has been crazy about ever since.
Nostalgia has crept in with the DC-3 is that some years ago there weren't many people, and suddenly guys opened their foot lockers and found their old photograph of their old C-47 that they flew. They became interested, wanted to know where it was and what had happened to it. And boy, it can still be around. We estimate there's still 1,200 still flying. South African Air Force have got 50 and so on. But we think that it will go on and on and on. And I've always prophesied that the only replacement for the DC-3 is another DC-3. But we just can't persuade Douglas to build them.
Surely he can't be serious. Did they really try to persuade Douglas to start building the DAC again? Well, you won't believe this, but the Dutch Dakota Association are buying another DAC, which they're going to mothball in a hangar at Amsterdam and roll out when the aircraft is 75 on the 17th of December 2010. Why are the Dutch so keen on the Dakota? Well, possibly because they remember it dropping agents behind enemy lines in the war, and almost certainly because KLM was the first European airline to use it back in the 1930s. In 1936, KLM's first managing director, Dr. Albert Plesman, ordered 24 of them. The Europeans hadn't seen anything like it. Here was an all-metal monoplane with a retractable undercarriage. Remember that only a few years before, passengers had been traveling in tri-motors, where air conditioning was provided by opening the window. And you could lean out of the window to get a good look at any interesting passengers boarding after you. When the tri-motors went, the Dutch, never ones to be left behind in innovation, started talking about a daily service leaving for Sydney, Australia. Suddenly, aviation had leapt ahead. KLM had pioneered the Douglas commercial line in Europe. In 1934, they entered a DC-2 in the London to Melbourne air race. And although it came second, it captured the public's imagination more than the winner, which was an aeroplane built for racing. And the Dutch national airline, ever efficient, took along fare-paying passengers to prove that leaving England for Australia could become an everyday occurrence. But in between the dream and reality came war. Exactly 10 years after the McRobertson Trophy race of 1934, the Douglas commercial, in military guise, was overhead the invasion beaches of D-Day. On June the 6th, 1944, 108 Dakotas dropped the main section of the 3rd Parachute Brigade. Then, as the Allies fought their way south, the DAC used makeshift airstrips to resupply them. Without it, Operation Overlord would not have been possible.
Think of the way we landed on strips in France. in Normandy on metal strips that were only a few, I suppose 100 yards long, which bounced. And I never checked my load. They gave us a slide rule to work out where to put all the freight and what it all weighed. And I didn't. I just made sure it was tied down. The slide rule never came out of his plastic bag, as far as I was concerned. Off you went. You opened the throttles, and at the end of the runway, if it wasn't allowable to get airborne, you pulled the wheels up. That got it airborne, all right.
In September 1944, it was Dakotas which towed gliders to Arnhem and the ill-fated Operation Market Garden to capture the bridges over the Rhine. Jimmy Edwards says their briefing made it all sound so simple, but casualties were heavy. On his fourth trip, Flight Lieutenant Edwards was on his way home from Arnhem when his Dakota came face to face with a German fighter.
And of course, it was on fire. Both engines and the whole of that cabin was full of flames and smoke. So I opened this bit here, which it says here, emergency exit, turn handle, throw open. I did that and the slipstream took it away immediately. And that, of course, drew all the flames and smoke this way. So the only thing I could do then was to stand on the seat, put my head out into the slipstream so I could breathe and hang on to the stick, which is this thing here, with one hand and just hold it off until it crashed. And then what happened was that mercifully, we hit this forest, but we didn't hit big trees. By some quirk of fate, we hit small trees, which slowed us up without breaking us up. And eventually it tipped over on its nose and it went almost vertical so that I was looking at the ground. And then mercifully also, instead of going that way, it went that way. It fell back onto the ground and the shock catapulted me through the roof. And I went up, landed on the roof and fell onto the ground and ran for my life. And then the whole thing blew up.
For that, Jimmy Edwards won the Distinguished Flying Cross, and a member of the same squadron, Flight Lieutenant David Lord, here on the right, won the VC. He carried on with a dropping mission, even though one wing of his Dakota was on fire. Some of his crew bailed out before it crashed. Lord did not. David Lord was finally unlucky, but the stories of what the Dakota put up with are legion. At times, it seemed almost indestructible. It was tough, and it needed to be.
There were no concentrated load points except where the landing gear landed and where you hooked on the engine. And there was no single spar. We had three spars and we had the skin taking some of the stress. The result was the things tended to crumple. It didn't, they really didn't do anything catastrophic unless it was a pretty strong crash.
I once landed at Hendon. I wasn't thinking. I bounced so often that the wing commander was almost hysterical. He sent for me and he just went, what? And I said, I suppose I was thinking of something else. Get the undercarriage checked, dear boy, he said. It was perfectly all right.
The DAC was so reliable that it was favored by wartime leaders as their personal transport. The Supreme Commander of Allied Forces in Europe, General Eisenhower, paid it the greatest compliment when he said that, along with the Jeep, the DAC was vital in winning the Second World War. Monty had one too. Actually, he had several of them, and in one, he personally designed the interior. He liked to study the terrain as he flew over old battlegrounds. So, in the heat of the desert, his navigator prepared a series of maps to help him. By May 1945, the war in Europe was over, and by August, Japanese prisoners of war were being carried by DAX in the Far East, where she'd had such a distinguished war career. In June 1948, she had another job to do in Berlin. When the Russians blockaded the roads to the city, the British and the Americans mounted the biggest and most incredible airlift ever. They called it Operation Planefare, and the Dakotas carried everything from clothes to coal. It was salvation for the people of Berlin, and salvation too for many struggling British airlines, the Lakers of this world, who suddenly found themselves with more work than they could cope with. Fortunes were made, more war surplus Dakotas were bought. Many of the airlines we use today in Britain were born in the Berlin airlift. military and civil, the DAX flew into Berlin by day and by night, in all weathers, sometimes landing one every minute. Was it the DAX finest hour? Possibly. But it was also the end of the line. In the sheds at Long Beach, California, production was stopped. And 50 years on, these sheds are still being put to good use for the production now of the MD-80 twin jet, the great-granddaughter of the Dakota. McDonnell Douglas are well aware of how important the development of their company, the DC-3, was.
We know that that aircraft is the one that got commercial aviation literally out of diapers and into the air. And it was the first airplane that could make money just by hauling passengers.
Here at the headquarters of what they now call McDonnell Douglas, the huge hangar where they once built DC-10s is being used as the temporary home for a famous ancestor. One of the last DC-2s is being restored to flying condition by the Douglas Historical Foundation. It carries the signature of Donald Wills Douglas, who, we mustn't forget, was the driving force behind this remarkable line. It seems that DWD encouraged tremendous loyalty, and 50 years later, his colleagues are giving up their time to work on his creation.
My 14-year-old son has flown virtually all over the world in DC-10s and Boeing 747s, and I had to bring Scott in here to show him what a commercial transport looked like that was outfitted with propellers and not jet engines, because he, like so many other youngsters today, have grown up in the world of space shuttle and space stations, and they don't realize that we had to have these aircraft in order to get where we are today, and we have to have today's jets for the future hypersonic aircraft of tomorrow. And this airplane, the DC-2, that first flew on May 11th, 1934, was a quantum leap over the aircraft that had flown just 10 years before it in 1924.
I'll say it was. Look at this, Croydon, London Airport in 1935. That's the year the Dakota first flew. Hard to believe that the rich and the famous, flying was still a bit elitist then, were content to travel in these Handley Page Heracles, the 1930s answer to the jumbo jet. But then they didn't know any better, even though the Americans were way ahead on the other side of the Atlantic. Flying from Britain in 1935 was still an adventure. You set off for somewhere in the empire, and you got there 3 weeks later. In contrast, at the same time, America's TWA, the Lindbergh line they called it, was pioneering the Douglas commercial, much more advanced in every way, and the first aeroplane of the people. It would bring down fares purely by carrying more passengers more quickly. In 1936, American Airlines used the DC-3 as a sleeper transport. It became temporarily fashionable to fly at night. Coast-to-coast journeys were more comfortable and less boring. And whilst not every flight was filled with pretty girls in silk dressing gowns, American Airlines were laughing all the way to the bank. Before the DC-3, they lost money. After it, they made it hand over fist. And that was the key. Because it was so economical, it was difficult to replace. After the war, the new British European Airways flew scores of them. Not all the pilots were Clark Gable lookalikes, but in the austerity of post-war Britain, it was just the aircraft the airline needed. A Dakota flew BEA's first ever scheduled service from Northolt in 1946 and did sterling work through the 50s, shuttling around Europe. Of course, it took 6 hours to Vienna and 11 to Athens, and because the DAC was unpressurized, boiled sweets came in handy. BEA quickly developed a habit of restyling their aircraft. The Dakotas became pioneers and were individually christened. In the early years, the pilots wore their old RAF uniforms because they had no others. Stewards and later stewardesses served fairly basic meals, though some people who'd never flown before bought packed lunches. For hundreds of hostesses, the Dakota was their entry into this not-so-glamorous world.
I think the first thing I thought about really was the size of them. They were very small, and once we were inside, it was the steep incline up to the cockpit that really rather staggered everybody, including the passengers. We used to walk up to check that the passengers were in. It was a big struggle, rather like mountaineering. And then coming back, it was almost a slide down to the tail again. And then, having checked everybody was in, we then mountaineer back to tell the captain they were all strapped in. One captain, I believe he was based up in Scotland, I never actually met him myself, but he would come onto the aircraft on one occasion with a white stick, and he would carefully tap his way all the way up to the front. And then he would sit down, and after a while he said, "Is nobody going to fly this thing?" And he said, "Never mind, I'll do it." So, complete with his white stick and glasses, he went into the cockpit. All the passengers were sitting there biting their fingers. And of course, they took off.
In 1952, BEA took two Dakotas and fitted them with Rolls-Royce Dart engines, later to be used in the Viscount. They were to be flying test beds. The pilots wore pressurized suits and flew at extraordinary heights.
The Americans in particular, of course, who'd been brought up on the Dakota. We used to fly across the top of Frankfurt, and they'd come up and say, "Type of aeroplane," because it was most unusual in 52 to have aeroplanes of any sort flying up there, apart from jet fighters. And we always came back and said, DC-3. And there was always a stunned silence from Rhine men. And eventually, one day, they scrambled three fighters, came up alongside the Dakota, which was sitting up there at 41,000 feet. And the guy leading the three pressed his button and said to Frankfurt Control, "Hell, it is a DC-3, I don't believe it." And they peeled away and off they went. And of course, afterwards, every day we passed over there, we used to get some crack from these Americans about this DC-3. But a superb airplane, even at that height, it used to handle properly and we had no problems with it.
The Dart Dakota is long gone. A more familiar sight today is this, the old lady abandoned in the long grass at the edge of airfields the world over. With scenes like this, can it be true, as some still say, that the Dakota will go on forever? Here in Southern California, they will tell you that the answer to that question is certainly yes. At Burbank Airport in Hollywood, where Bob Hope keeps his private plane, the US aircraft company are buying up DACs like there's no tomorrow. In their hangar, they rather ungraciously chop up the fuselage, insert a new section to make room for four more seats, but most significantly, remove the old Pratt & Whitney Wasp engines and replace them with a modern engine called the PT6, because the DAC's airframe will go on, even if the engines won't. All this produces a strange-looking aeroplane called the Turbo 3.
We're targeting in the immediate future for a production rate of one aircraft per month. We feel we'll increase this to two aircraft per month within a few years.
Is there a bit of a romantic thing here as well about keeping the Dakota going?
Oh, indeed. Indeed there is, amongst our staff and amongst our customers.
It's not only in the United States that they've considered revamping the DAC. Back at Stansted, where we began, Air Atlantique are thinking along the same lines. It's getting harder and harder to find spare engines and more difficult to overhaul the old ones, which in the long term threatens Air Atlantique's Dakota joyrides and the enjoyment they give to thousands of DAC fans every year.
You get the wartime enthusiast pilots coming along. And it's wonderful to feel the enthusiasm as they tell you that they were at Arnhem or over the Rhine, or they were in the parachute brigade regiments, and indeed lots of enthusiasm. Then of course you have the man of about 40 who will come along and tell you that his father flew the DC-3, no doubt during the war. And lastly but not least, of course, you have a youngster of 8 or 10 who will come along and upset you greatly by saying, "My grandfather used to fly these, you see," and so anyway, that's it. Indeed, the passengers are terrific.
What will all those passengers, those enthusiasts who hold the DAC in such affection, do when her time is really up? Flying, like those early days of designing aeroplanes, will never be quite the same again.
We were young. I don't suppose there were more than 20 of us, and we were in one room attached to the engineering department, and we were in close contact with the shop. We knew everybody in the shop, everybody knew us. We spent half our time in the shop, and we went home at night just filled with exhilaration. Well, you know, as things get bigger and more complicated, and you got to fill out papers and you have to get approvals and all that sort of thing, it isn't quite so much fun. But we really enjoyed it, and we enjoyed working for Doug.
Why do you think it has survived for 50 years?
Well, just because it was the best. It was the best.
Rising, RPM 1200. Start test complete. Text office on ground flight switch.
For sheer nostalgia, and most of us seem to indulge, the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight provides all you need. But air displays, the contrast of thrills and excitement, is laid on by the red arrows. The air and ground crews, in typical service shorthand, call the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight the BBMF. A rather matter-of-fact reference to a group of aircraft that never fails to produce deep emotions in the thousands of people who see the Lancaster, Hurricane and Spitfire in the skies of Britain during the dozens of displays they give in spring and summer. Guernsey and Jersey have their turn to see them perform in September each year. Always centre of the formation is the Lancaster, the Lank. This is the only one still flying, and she's kept airborne by a team whose dedication goes beyond service requirements. Over 7,000 Lancasters were produced. The first operational flight was on the night of March the 3rd, 1942. It carried a heavier bomb load than any other World War II aircraft and dropped two-thirds of Bomber Command's total tonnage during the war. But her tasks were not all aimed to destroy. She dropped food to the starving Dutch people, and almost 75,000 ex-prisoners of war stepped back on home soil from the fuselage of a Lank. If something designed by man to kill fellow men can have beauty, then it must be the Spitfire. Its prototype first flew 47 years ago, and 22,000 of them were built. Memorial Flight maintains four of the few left. 36 different marks of the aircraft were produced, mainly because newer German aircraft outclassed the earlier marks, so her armaments were made more devastating, and she was modified to take the 1600 horsepower Merlin engine, which gave the Spitfire a top speed of over 400 miles an hour. The Spitfire took much of the glory in the Battle of Britain, but it was the Hurricane and its pilots which destroyed three-fifths than the aircraft brought down in the battle. The Hurricane was the first combat aircraft to exceed 300 miles an hour in level flight. She was also the first monoplane to enter squadron service when she replaced the Gladiator. And the Hurricane was the first fighter in the war to be armed with 8 machine guns in her wings. Only 3 are still flying. The Flight has 2 of them. The Memorial Flight is a mobile remembrance of those terrible, tragic war years, but Britain still has more permanent reminders. ...116,000 men and women of the Commonwealth Air Forces died in the Second World War. Over 20,000 of them, British, Australians, New Zealanders, Canadians, South Africans and Indians, have no known graves. They're commemorated on the Air Forces Memorial at Runnymede. The flat farmlands of Britain's eastern counties were once a mosaic of airfields during the Second World War, British and American. Many have been torn up, others remain operational stations, and a few have been left to nature to heal the scars of war. These huts, which must evoke many a memory, happy and sad, to Air Force veterans, were once part of RAF Woodall Spa, the former base of several squadrons, including 617, the Dambusters. Lincoln and its cathedral had a particular place in the hearts and minds of aircrew. In 1975, the city adopted the Flight's Lancaster in recognition of the Bomber Command's long associations with Lincoln and the county, which still contains many operational airfields. One of them is now the base of the Memorial Flight, RAF Coningsby. The Royal Air Force's first squadron of Phantoms was formed here in 1969. The Phantom is considered to be one of the most successful post-war military aircraft. Its service has been in several roles, including as a strike aircraft and an air defense fighter. Alongside the runway in the lineup of Phantoms is the working home for the 13 permanent crew of the flight and its commander, Squadron Leader Scott Anderson, who pilots the Lancaster on displays.
The flight started at Biggin Hill in 1957 when there was a decision taken to form a Battle of Britain flight. And at that stage, the flight consisted of one Hurricane and two Mark 19 Spitfires and two Mark 16 Spitfires. And from that stage, the flight has sort of grown and developed slightly. We lost two Mark 16s in flying accidents. We had two Spitfires given to us, and with one Hurricane given to us. And 44 Squadron at Waddington managed to get hold of a Lancaster, renovate it, and now we have that.
We just heard a Phantom scream by. How does the flight fit in with the normal operation of RAF Coningsby?
With a great deal of goodwill on behalf of most of Coningsby people, actually. We are a task unit here, and we are actually an RAF established display team. I'm the only established officer on the flight. All the other air crew are people on secondary duties. So the fighter pilots, Spitfire and Hurricane pilots, actually come from the Phantom fleet. All of the aircraft are, you know, coming up for 40 years old, and they're all vintage airplanes. Yes, there's a great deal of sort of care and consideration taken. It's not treated the same harsh, you know, handling that it had during the war, obviously. Basically, the instrumentation is 1940s, so we don't actually fly in cloud, or we try not to. We don't fly faster than 200 knots. They used to be cleared up to about 300 during the war. It reduces the fatigue on the aeroplane. And we also try and keep the G loading on the aeroplane and maneuver down to 1.5. That sort of generally eases the aeroplane a lot. Obviously, fighters during the war were pulling a lot of G in maneuver. We restrict ours to 4G, which is not an awful lot, and that's why our display maneuvers are slightly more restricted than some of the other fighter operators. We like to think that our aircraft will be going probably long after theirs have been grounded for fatigue reasons. On the airspeed, the fighters are reduced to 275 knots, and once again, we have the same problem of aged instrumentation, so we don't fly in cloud with them. And oddly enough, we don't fly in rain with them because it damages the propellers. There is no such thing as a finite fatigue life for any of our aeroplanes. They're basically on what's called on-condition maintenance. And that means that they will keep on going, as long as the money keeps coming in, until the engineers find something that it's uneconomic to put right. It's now the end of October. By the end of September, we should, in theory, have had all the bids in for next year's requests for the flight. Some come to us and some go direct to the branch of Ministry of Defence that sort out our displays. We get somewhere in the order of 360, 370 requests to come in. That is pruned to about 150, and that's spread over the display season from April through to September. We start off very early in the season, around Easter time, with one or two displays, and it works up to a crescendo in September, where we do about a third of our season's flight. We normally reckon to be self-contained. There are some occasions when we go on long sorties away from base where we get support from a Devon aeroplane from 207 Squadron at Northolt, but that's the exception, not the rule. Normally we carry our own ground crew in the Lancaster, so we have no real problems at all with support, especially since we largely operate out of civilian airfields. The winter is just the same as the summer, just slightly different. We have about 4,000 visitors a year, so we have a fair number of people that we see through the flight, largely wartime air crew and young people. And there's a great deal of work, actually, in sorting out the next year's display season and writing up reports on this season.
And it's during the winter that the Lancaster, Spitfires and Hurricanes are serviced and made ready for the next season. Here at Coningsby each year, the aircraft are given a routine minor check, which may sound as though it involves just a cursory glance at a few bits and pieces and maybe an oil change. But in the RAF, a minor check is a very serious and careful undertaking. Every 4 years, the Lancaster spends the winter away from home when she has a major check, which means flying her down to Oxfordshire to the RAF station just outside the Thameside town of Abingdon, better known perhaps for its connections with English kings and the motor car industry. A major check means the Lancaster is taken apart, not quite down to the last rivet, but no section of the aircraft escapes a severe lookover from the RAF engineers. The officer who had just come to the end of his two-year posting as the man responsible for the flight's engineering is Flight Lieutenant Charles Ness.
Well, I think the major problem is that we're dealing with aeroplanes which left operational service in the Royal Air Force and elsewhere in the world many years ago, and consequently there are far fewer spares around that we would than we would wish. And obviously spares procurement gives us a major problem.
Do you need to improvise very much?
An enormous amount, yes. We manufacture many things ourselves to the original drawing, and things that are outside our own capability, we enlist the help of other units within the service who have a greater manufacturing capability than we as aircraft engineers have, or indeed we contract to industry. All our ground crew on the flight are full-time RAF tradesmen who have all come to the flight from normal operational jobs. We don't have any special training within the service to equip them for this job. Their basic skill of hand is instilled in them during their basic training and during the continuation training they get in their careers. And when they come here, it's very much a homegrown expertise, and they pick up the peculiarities of the airplanes which they're working on. The vast majority of all the airplanes on the Battle of Britain flight, and by majority I mean majority of structure, are original. Obviously there are areas where we have to replace bits and pieces with modern, recently manufactured equipment, but as we always aim to stick as close as possible to the original. But we make no pretense that what we are flying is representative aircraft, and we have had to make some concessions to originality to keep the airplanes in the air. It's always a bit of a worry come shortly after Christmas, when normally you hit the bottom of the aircraft strip and you start the rebuild, and you start to wonder whether it'll all go back together within the required timescale. We can always get it back together, but the big trick is making sure that it's in one piece by the date that OCBBMF needs it to start his training. We don't fail normally, but it still makes your heart jump every winter. We have an absolutely finite limit on each aircraft as to the number of hours we're allowed to fly. For the Spitfires, we're allowed to fly 35 hours on each aircraft. For the two Hurricanes, 50 hours each. And for the Lancaster, it's currently 75 hours. And of course, those flying limitations must take into account not just our displays, but all our training, our air tests, our transit times. So piecing together the sort of flying program that we mount each year is a massive jigsaw puzzle for OCBBMF, and in fact occupies most of his time during the winter months.
Piecing together the massive three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle of the Lancaster and painting her ready for the next season takes 5 months. The airframes, electrics and instruments are all checked here at Abingdon by the repair squadron. But the four Rolls-Royce Merlin engines are taken out and sent back to Coningsby for their major check. RAF Coningsby has been home for more than 20 squadrons over the years. During the war, the station came under Bomber Command. Now, with its Phantoms, it's part of Strike Command. The Merlin, which also powers the Spitfires and Hurricanes, is the most famous of the Rolls-Royce piston engines. One of the men who keeps the engines in tune is Corporal Kevin Martin. How did he get a job which is the envy of many aircraft enthusiasts?
Well, I volunteered for it. I asked for everything that I now get.
And was the test to get into the flight fairly severe?
Mainly a matter of luck, really, and happening to apply at the right time. They needed somebody about the time that I applied, and had about a year to wait before I actually got the job on the flight.
And why did you apply?
That's a difficult one to answer there. I think I wanted a change. I fancy doing something different.
Did the designers of these days, for the Spitfire, Hurricane and Lancaster, did they consider the fitter and mechanic? Was it fairly easy to work on in that way?
In many ways, these aircraft are easier to work on than modern aircraft because, as you can see looking at the Hurricane here, you can remove so many panels from around the components, and really the access for working is excellent.
And modern aircraft, are they simpler than this? I mean, there's so many cables and struts and wires. Are the modern aircraft a lot simpler inside?
Again, another difficult one to answer. Once you know what you're looking at, really. There's nothing complicated about these aircraft at all. Certainly, it looks a right sort of mess inside with all the pipes and control lines and everything. But when you take it system by system, they're very, very simple.
During the war days, the ground crew often felt the aircraft were theirs and the air crew merely borrowed them. Is that still true?
I suppose, yes, we do look on them as our aircraft. When you've got such a small outfit and so few aircraft, you do get to know each aircraft almost as a living thing.
As an outsider looking in, they would think of your job as being rather romantic, travelling all around Britain with these aircraft. Is it one long holiday for you?
You want to try living out of a suitcase for 6 months of the year? It's got its moments. Yes, it is good fun. However, it's, as with any job, I suppose, it's nice to come home.
The permanent ground crew can lead something of a normal life during the autumn and winter. Apart from working on the aircraft, they have leave to take, because come the spring, the season begins, and there is little time for the next 6 months as the flight moves from airport to airport throughout Britain.
I think that the crews on this flight work just as hard, if not harder, than any other air crew throughout the service. I think the thing to bear in mind is that, with the exception of OCBBMF, all of the air crew are part-time. They have full-time jobs on this station, and they work at least 5 days a week at those. And then when their compatriots take the weekend off to recover, during the summer, these gentlemen are climbing into their aeroplanes and putting on air shows all over the country and indeed all over Europe. And they can expect to work something like 3 weekends in 4 during the summer months. So they work very hard and it's no holiday.
For the Channel Islands program, the aircraft are based at Jersey Airport and their first display is over Guernsey. The takeoff is a more genteel performance than during those war days. And there are no short circuits when it comes to procedures.
25, rolling.
180.
Okay, no problems.
High throttles, full power, high throttles. Sure. Airspeed running.
This Lancaster PA474 was built by Vickers Armstrong at Chester, but she was just too late for active service. She was a basic reconnaissance bomber, modified for the Far East Tiger Force. But with the sudden end of the war in Asia, she was remodified and spent 6 years on photo reconnaissance in Africa. Her working days ended 20 years ago, after a spell as a flying testbed for equipment used in swept wing flight trials. Guernsey's St. Peter Port Harbour provides the perfect setting for an air display, with Castle Cornet in the foreground and Herman Jettu as part of the backdrop. Wing Commander Bob Stanford Tuck, one of the most famous Battle of Britain pilots, did not welcome the change when he first flew the Hurricane. He'd spent 1,000 hours in Spitfires and found the Hurricane larger, heavier and slower. But after a couple of flights in her and a few aerobatics, he realized the Hurricane's potential as a destroyer of enemy aircraft with the better forward vision and firepower. The Spitfire doesn't have the menacing look of most wartime fighters, at least not to the casual observer. No doubt German aircrew told a different story. The average pilot needed 50 hours in a Spitfire to become operational. In the early days, many had far less before they took on the German pilots, veterans of Spain, Poland, Holland, Belgium, and France. The cost of keeping the aircraft flying is worked out in thousands of pounds and hundreds of man hours. Worthwhile if the memorial flight can play its role in reminding us of the cost of war. It's hoped the flight will be part of air displays until the end of this century and beyond. And that will depend upon the skill of the RAF men and women who fly and maintain the aircraft. The Lancaster was conceived out of failure. Its prototype was the Manchester, a twin-engine bomber, which proved to be a disaster, underpowered with unreliable engines. Designer Roy Chadwick knew he had a good airframe, so the wings were extended and four Merlins attached, producing the most successful of Bomber Command's heavy aircraft.
If you go back in the flight's charter, we're actually established to commemorate the Royal Air Force's major battle honours. We see that as being the Battle of Britain, and now with the advent of the Lancaster, the Battle of Germany, if you like, and also to remind the general public of the part played by the Royal Air Force in the defence of the UK. That's what it actually says. We, although it's not established, I think tend to see ourselves more as a memorial to the people that designed, built, and maintained the aeroplane, and those that actually fought in them. I think most people see them as, you know, rather pretty little aeroplanes, but in actual fact, they represent a great deal more than that.